We're going to do something of an experiment here today. It'll be more of an experiment for you than it will be for me. Those of you who know me will know exactly what I'm going to say next. I don't use PowerPoint presentation, so there will be nothing to distract you from behind there. You can focus on my every word at the front here. But I am also going to do something of an experiment because I am not completely in a technophile dungeon. I am going to use this thing here, at least for this moment. But while I'm doing this, there is going to be some slight disruption, because Janine Robinson is going to be distributing a flyer. This is blatant self-promotion going on here now. You might as well know it, I'm an honest person. the background to some of the things I'm going to be saying today, although not directly, if anybody does want to find out more about this and is prepared to fork out money for it, you can get access to it through my book that just came out last week with Terry Rigney called Living on the Edge, Rethinking Poverty, Class and Schooling. And many of the ideas that I'm going to be talking about today lie in the background. Now, the other departure I'm going to have here, keeping in title with my title of Interrupting and Disrupting, is that I'm not going to talk about a research project at all. I'm going to ruminate I won't do quite the performance that I know my follow-on performer will do, Bill Green, where I'll dance on the podium and run up and down the aisles and do things like that, but I'm going to reach back into my memories and talk about some of the things about the topic. My topic today is Interrupting and Puncturing, what is called the neoliberal straitjacket, by promulgating the pedagogy of the socially just school. Now, I'm not even going to get time to talk about the socially just school, given the time, but you can surmise what that will be, and if you want to know more about it, I've got another book coming out with that with Barry Down and Rob Haddam and Peter McEnany pretty soon. But I want to do a couple of things. So first of all, I want to start out by doing a little bit of context setting around the notion of this notion of the neoliberal straitjacket. And this will lead me into the second part of my discussion, which I'm going to comment on some notions about interruption, or possibly is it disruption, based on my own experience about what it might mean to work under the radar in this context of the socially just, what I'm calling the socially just school. Now, I want to start out here by saying that the starting point for me on this, we're really coming back to Thomas Friedman's notion in his book, The Lexus and the Olive Tree, in which he actually argued that one of the things that we've done in Western societies in the last three or four decades is that we've pretty unquestioningly taken on a one-size-fits-all ideological garment. It's a rather nice way of putting it. And he says, in effect, what's going on here is that we've taken this to be the only garb, the only form of garb. It's the only model on the rack. And what the hell if it doesn't fit, as he says. We can put a little more padding around the elbows, you know, that's for the people who are kind of left out there. But, you know, basically, you know, we've taken on this particular model and, you know, we're not going to quickly get rid of that. Oh, thanks very much. Now, I want to tease out for a moment, and you're probably well aware of these, and just keep this notion of the straitjacket going for a minute there, some of the threads of this multicoloured dream coat. They're familiar enough ones to you. The supremacy of the market, the unchallenged supremacy of the market, the fact that the private sector ought to be the model to be slavishly followed in all of our work, in schools and in other places. Small government, state and shrinking state bureaucracies, and if you work in those sort of places, you'll know what that feels like too. Privatising of state-owned enterprises, opening up of industries to unregulated competition, and the whole notion of deregulation in every possible way. Now, in this presentation here today, I want to challenge that dream coat as the required garb for schooling. I don't think we ought to have taken that one on in anything like the way we have. And in a recent issue of the International Journal of Critical Pedagogy, Tricia Kress and some of her colleagues did a really nice job. I recommend the issue to you and the articles that are in it, in which they pursue notions of critical pedagogy working under the radar and, as she calls it, working off the grid. And I was really quite taken by working under the radar, because it's a term I have been using, although it's not been picked up by that many of my colleagues, for probably around about 20 or so years now. And I want to talk a bit about how that actually has taken formation. One of the most common things I've heard over the years when trying to work with teachers and people in schools about taking on some of the ideas of the socially critical is that that's a pretty nice idea in theory, but there's no room for it. There's absolutely no room for it at all. I have to cover all this stuff. It sounds pretty subversive, and by the way, I'm not prepared to actually lose my job. End of the story. That's pretty much how the kind of conversation goes. Now, like Cress and her colleagues, I've long argued that critical pedagogy is not about waiting for the arrival of utopian conditions and then doing something. That's never going to happen. It hasn't happened in my lifetime, and as you can see, I'm pretty old, and it won't happen in your lifetimes either. I think we have to always think about critical pedagogy as working within regimes, within structures and conditions that actually exist. Indeed, I would argue that's the whole purpose of critical pedagogy, to push back against, to speak back, to interrupt, and in the process of doing that, create the conditions for a more democratic and socially just alternative world. So I think that's the kind of starting point I have. In another interesting piece fairly recently, David Stovall, in writing the foreword to Paul Gorski's book called Cultivating Socially Just Teachers, makes a rather interesting argument, I think, he says that what's going on at the moment, and Rob will resonate well with this one because he uses the same analogy himself, is enough to make us pull our hair out and run screaming out of the room. I mean, it is, when you start to think about it, something. We are in the zoo-like kind of times, really. And Stovall says that what we have to do is we have to have the courage to break the silence on this stuff. Doing this, he says, requires cultivating a very different mindset. We've lived too long, Stovall argues, in the silence of our own ineptitude. And in doing this, what we do with our students, all the while being unprepared to engage the realities of marginalisation, racialisation and criminalisation of our schools, given that he's talking from the American context. So when you engage in stirring up trouble, and I'm reputed for doing that, I was described by my dean the other day as one of the disruptive bastards in the school. He used that language. And he meant it in an effective way, not a demeaning way, by the way. I took it as a sign of affection. we have to be prepared to deal with some messiness, and we have to learn how to deal with it if we're going to get to what Stovall calls the victory condition in troubling times. And here I'm heartened by going back, and when you get old, you kind of read stuff that you never had a chance to read. Eric Fromm. I've been reading Eric Fromm recently, in his Revolution of Hope and Paulo Freire's Pedagogy of the Oppressed. And I think these people have some interesting things to say. And one of the things that I took from Fromm was really a really most captivating sentence when he talks about having what he calls fortitude. And now fortitude can be quite easily summed up in his words, he says, saying no when the rest of the world wants to hear yes. Okay, and I think that's a really kind of interesting starting point. Now, elsewhere in my work, I've argued for quite some time about what being critical means. It doesn't mean what many people think it means. I think what it means fundamentally to me is about being prudent. And by that I mean acting in ways that are legitimate in the light of the obstacles and the impediments and the interferences, and starting from that point. As Fromm says, it's no good approaching things with an unrealistic forcing of circumstances that cannot occur. Now, the best way I can describe this is to use an analogy. And in recent times, I've become an ardent cat owner and inveterate cat watcher. And to take from Fromm, he says it's a bit like the crouched tiger, which will only jump when the moment for jumping has come. And I think if we take that point from Fromm, I think we get a really kind of interesting take on that sort of not trying to force things that cannot occur. Cress and her colleagues talk about the kind of educational institutions that we're required to work in with these kind of neoliberal dream coats. And the fact that we can't become martyrs in trying to do this stuff and to do it in haphazard kinds of ways. One of the most significant things, I think, is that critical pedagogy is actually not that radical. We often have it presented to us that we're talking about something pretty kind of radical here. But I think it's only radical in the sense that we're trying to unstitch or unhinge a whole lot of things that have, as Adorno would call them, that are alien, sort of alien interlopers. And I'm talking here about the testing regimes, about standards, about league tables, about marketised stuff and punitive approaches. These are the alien things to our work. You'd be surprised. It's not the critical that's the alien at all. What I take from this is that enriching learning spaces is the starting point for where I think we should be working much of this stuff through. And this ought to not be about an approach for the most disenfranchised, marginalised kids. This is something that ought to be at the centre of any form of good education. I'll kind of run over some stuff here, and if anybody does want to follow this stuff up further in the paper, I can do it. I should get rid of that image, by the way, out of the way there, if I can, which I probably can't. So the technology has overdone me here. I'll just leave it then for the minute. There are no kind of... here we go, thank you. There are no sort of formulas or prescriptions for any of this kind of approach. I think rather they reside in the lived experiences of those who've dared to work under the radar. The interesting point is that they don't stare at with an overt kind of an agenda of trying to bring on any kind of revolution. In fact, I've gone back to reading Postman and Weingartner's really interesting book called The Soft Revolution. Which is quite an interesting book, because the byline on that book is really, it's really got a subtitle, the Student Handbook for Learning How to Turn Schools Around. And the point there in Postman and Weingartner's book is that it's the analogy of judo, where you actually try to harness the forces to use back against your opponent. And I think in some ways that's not a bad analogy for what we ought to be doing with this sort of interruption that I'm putting forward here. What I want to do now is give you a half a dozen or so ideas about the basis of the kind of forms of interruption that I've found. First of all, trying to engage in outright rejection of neoliberal policies is probably a fantasy. It's probably not going to work. Rather, what we need to be doing is getting inside these regimes, trying to work out what parts of them we can realistically appropriate and recraft. For example, and this comes out of some of the most interesting work I've done, I think unquestionably has been in the period I was in South Australia here at Flinders, but one of the ones was the idea about reductionist forms of appraisal, which are rampant here, and undermining these by recasting them in terms of being conversations. And they take on a radically different intent when you kind of do that. And we saw that in some schools in the northern suburbs. The process then gets ticked off, but effectively what's gone on is a significant undermining and the presenting of an alternative. I think, secondly, doing something that starts from quite a diametrically opposed position from that which is stipulated or mandated, and then backward mapping onto to the original design. And here I'm thinking of a school we worked out again in the northern suburbs, which Peter McInerney and I called Plainsville, and I won't blow the real name of the school. But in that school, kids were actually learning how to develop their own learning plans, and then were actually working out how to actually map those onto the statewide curriculum framework. And I have to say, it was a pretty sophisticated process that was going on there, in a context in which many teachers didn't even understand what the national, what the statewide curriculum framework was. 5 minutes, right? Thanks. So I think there's a really kind of neat example there about how we can actually begin to push back into some of those kinds of things. A third example is working at creating what I call a well-developed philosophy of a socially critical kind. And one of the things that we've started to get a strong sense of is that neoliberalism is a concept that we've allowed to inhabit our minds. It does have a material reality, for sure, but I think we become complicit in going along with that stuff when the alternatives, we could do the alternatives. And I think my view is that it does tend to crumble quite readily when it's actually confronted with a well-thought-out alternative. And I think one of the bases on which I've seen this happen repeatedly is the school that actually has the question guiding it around how are we in this place working for the least advantaged kids? When that becomes a sort of a driving philosophy behind it and the things that they do become central to that, these other ideas find it a fairly inhospitable place in which to live. Fourthly, engaging in forms of solidarity. And I think in many times these ideas, these neoliberal ideas, have a life and a fertility that grows out of isolation. We are continually being isolated and picked off. When we actually kind of engage in processes of solidarity, and I'll give you an example here. Many parents have a great sense of unease about the issues of standards, about the issues of testing. And when we begin to bring those into the kind of orbit of our kind of work, we're able to present alternatives. We're able to speak back to those things. The fifth thing, that's what I call being prudent, by the way. Publicising and celebrating successes in the way in which the school is working, schools and teachers are working under the radar and against the grain, when it's appropriate, I sound a bit like Abbott here, doesn't it? When it's appropriate to do so. By that I mean, when this is something that isn't going to be damaging or threatening, going public when it's an appropriate time to do that. Sixthly, a preparedness to jettison the sculpted curriculum and to start from the lives and experiences, a theme we've heard much in the last few days. Start from the lives, experiences and aspirations of our students and their communities. Capturing the teachable kind of moment. And I'm thinking here of the work of interesting work of John Portelli and his colleagues, where they actually talk about how they kind of do that. Seventhly, and I'm almost there, Robin, the process of winning hearts and minds, and to that extent, I think we should be able to make sure that we do a number of things in winning those hearts and minds around the socially just school, that it is in fact possible to do things within existing structures. This is not an anything goes kind of strategy. It is a process that does involve demonstrating rigour and a relevant curriculum, and it's about stretching kids' minds. But I think above all, and I'll finish on this point, it is about seeing the work as a political act. And I'll finish on the point by saying, if we don't see that work as a political act, then we're the only ones around the work who don't see it that way. Thanks very much.